Schedule with this talk about Kashmir. I'm afraid it's a very depressing talk, probably, but that's rather our line, I'm afraid. The situation there is extremely grave, and it involves a lot of issues that concern us all, obviously. I mean, among them, human rights, self-determination, and not to say the least, international security. Kashmir is the only state in India with a Muslim majority population, and its status has been a long-standing source of friction and tension between India and Pakistan. Anyway, the conflict has an extremely long history, but until last year, the state of Jammu and Kashmir nominally enjoyed special autonomy. I'm sorry, it's very difficult. The mic isn't really working. I wonder what it would be
better
to use it.
It could be better without.
Is that
without
better?
The mic.
But I'm actually holding it touching my mouth.
Why did you close?
I think that's
no, it isn't, because when I hold it away, you can't hear me.
That's fine.
Is that all right?
Better.
Okay. All right. You said not last time, but we'll try again. Anyway, in early August, India's BJP party government passed resolutions to bifurcate the territory and to end its autonomy, which it had enjoyed, as well as the statehood, and bring Jammu and Kashmir under the direct rule of Delhi. And at the same time, they imposed a crippling lockdown on the region. And this has gravely escalated tension both in Kashmir and between the two nuclear powers of Pakistan and India. And Nitasha Kaul, our speaker tonight, is herself Kashmiri. And she's a person of many parts. She's an economist, a novelist, and a poet. And she's also an academic. She's currently associate professor in politics and international relations at the University of Westminster. She's spoken and published widely on various themes, including social theory, democracy, and post-colonial critique, with a particular focus on Bhutan and Kashmir. And we're delighted to have us here with us tonight to give us a great understanding of this very distressing situation and this disturbing present impasse we appear to be in the state. So thank you. Let us give her a round.
Yeah, it's working.
Even if not, I mean, I think I'm lagging. Okay, thank you all for being here today. It is it feels like a tremendously heavy burden to go on and on saying the same thing, as I have often been, especially over the last few months. But it feels really important to engage more and more people from as diverse sets of backgrounds and global locations and thought locations, because what we are facing is just so important and so unprecedented. So I'm going to speak for about 40-45 minutes and then have you ask me questions, and I'm really looking forward to that, because that's when I think that I can really really make an intervention and try and express, I suppose, some of the despair and the need for hope that I feel. So, and thank you, Susanna, for introducing me, and to David, Susanna, and all of you, the Café Diplo people, for organizing this. So Kashmir is, I don't know, maybe I want to ask you at first, how many people here have been to Kashmir? Can you just, at any point? Okay, so I'm okay, all right, so that. So Kashmir, you know, when we use the term Kashmir, of course, here in this room, it doesn't need saying, but Kashmir, the idea of Kashmir is what thinks about it, is this whole erstwhile territory of that princely state of Jammu and Kashmir, which has a history that is multilingual, multicultural, and also multi-religious, and that goes back centuries. Starting from being an important site of early Buddhism, to having various Hindu rulers, to having Central Asian Mughal and Afghan originating dynasties, to then the Sikh rule, and then comes this ignominious moment in 1846 when it is sold by the Treaty of Amritsar from, you know, when it is bought from the Sikhs and sold to the Dogra king. So in the history of Kashmir, that is a really important moment. And when we look back to the fact that a territory with all of its people could be sold for an equivalent of something like £75,000, I think that if we just react to that and say, well, yes, we, as an imperial power, the British, we did it, and therefore, because we did it, somehow we can wash our hands off that whole story and say, sorry, we can't do anything else, which is what the position, I think, seems to have been in recent years. So from David Cameron to Boris Johnson, the politicians seem to be saying, well, we kind of caused the mess in the first place, so we don't want to be saying anything. And I think that's only half the story. I think that if we look back, the history of the world is rife with people being treated not in the ways that they ought to have been under previous imperial, colonial sort of, you know, ways of managing populations and territories. But I think it behoves us to think that we can do better in the present. And that, I think, is why here and everywhere else, the international community, and especially the UK, we all have a role in making sure that the past does not continue to dictate the present, and that we cannot just keep looking away from what has unfolded since. The Dogra rule in the 19th century was tremendously oppressive. There's historical work that, you know, if you want to read further, a particular book called Hindu Rulers, Muslim Subjects. And this was a time of repressive taxation and all sorts of other, you know, difficulties that the majority Muslim population of the region faced. This led to, at the start of the 20th century, an incipient Kashmiri nationalism, which was very socialist in its origin. So that, at that point, in the first part of the 20th century, you have two competing versions of nationalism. And here I'm referring to Kashmiri nationalism, not the Indian anti-colonial nationalism. So you have two versions of Kashmiri nationalism. One of them is a version that is located more in the identity of people as Muslims, right? The Muslim conference. And the other version of nationalism, which was typified mostly by Sheikh Abdullah, who's known as the Lion of Kashmir, an important leader, that version of nationalism sought to sort of bargain with India in a secular Kashmiri nationalist, you know, with that sort of a voice. And that nationalism is the one that fell by the wayside. In fact, as early as the 50s, in 1953, when Sheikh Abdullah was removed from power. But at that point, it was this politics between the two great men, Sheikh Abdullah and Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India. And as great men did in the past, they thought they made compacts, but then they made compacts with other people, and then when things didn't work out, people were removed from power, and the Kashmiri people, in the bargain, just stood to lose, and have since then stood to lose so much from it. So there's that part of the story. There's also two competing nationalisms in India in the middle part, you know, from maybe the second, third decade of the 20th century onwards. These two nationalisms, again, one of them is a secular democratic, a nationalism that claims itself to be secular democratic, as typified by Congress and Nehru, etc. And then there is this other version of Indian nationalism, which is Hindu nationalism. And that Hindu nationalism, in fact, an important moment in that story is 1925, when the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, the RSS, was founded. Now, the RSS, I think, is something that everyone everywhere ought to know a lot more about, because the RSS is not like any other political party. It claims itself to be an NGO. It has millions of members across the country that are part of every profession, from lawyers to farmers to everywhere. The RSS also has a whole affiliate of organizations called the Sangh Parivar, the family of Hindu organizations. And the RSS, that RSS idea of India is of India as a Hindu nation, is that India ought to be a Hindu nation, and that non-Hindus can live within India, but on their existence in India would be based upon the benevolent acceptance of the Hindus themselves. So their rights are not going to be derived as civic rights between individuals and the state, but as rights that are given or granted to them through the largesse of the Hindu majority, which can at any point choose to take away some of those rights. Now, why is the RSS important to this whole story? And I'll get to the present moment very shortly. The RSS is important because for most of the history of independent India, the RSS was a banned organization. One of their former members, Nathuram Godse, was Gandhi's assassin. So the RSS also did not actively take part in the anti-colonial struggle. And the early leaders of the RSS explicitly spoke about their admiration for Hitler. So, so these people wrote about their admiration for Hitler because they loved the idea of a pure nation. And they thought of replicating that idea in India. And this is something that is part of, you know, of scholarly knowledge. It is out there for everyone to know. Kashmir for them as a Muslim majority region was always something that was problematic. I mean, there's that whole story of the line of control, the accession, the plebiscite that didn't happen in the 40s and all of that. But even putting that in a bracket to the side for one moment, the very idea of Kashmir, of claiming Kashmir as part of India and only, you know, and only as India, was to them very central. And it was a project that for most of the decades of the 20th century of post-colonial, of independent India, was not part of the main political script of the country. But with the start of the 90s, and especially with the Hindutva resurgence, Hindutva, the idea of India as a Hindu nation, Hinduism, the political use of Hinduism, with the start of the 90s, that starts to gain ascendancy. And in 2014, with the election of the Indian Prime Minister Modi, and then in 2019, with his re-election, this has become the mainstream of Indian politics. So it has become possible, even in my lifetime, certainly, people wouldn't, and of course the generation before me, people would not have imagined this kind of transformation that has happened in the country. Of having a member of parliament, of someone being given a ticket to contest in parliamentary elections, who says, the assassin of Gandhi was a patriot. And then to be appointed to a defense panel by the government. This is Pragya Thakur, currently serving Indian BJP MP. So the political discourse has shifted completely to the right-wing Hindu nationalist BJP and its ideological parent, the RSS, which was pretty unimaginable for many of the decades of the 20th century. So there's that. And now, what they are pursuing ever more, and this time once they've gotten re-elected, the BJP has gotten re-elected, it was part of their manifesto to do to Kashmir what they are now doing. Because this idea of claiming Kashmir was always an unfinished project for their version of nationalism and for their idea of India. So what happens on August the 5th is that for a few days before, August the 5th, 2019, for a few days before, everyone hears this news of large numbers of troops being moved in. And this is already a most militarized zone, but then you have, tens of thousands of more troops being brought in. People are stocking up on food and medicines, and there is rumor rife everywhere that something's about to happen. One doesn't know what is going to happen up until the night of Sunday, the 4th of August. Monday morning, I was leaving the country I was traveling and leaving on the night of the 4th, so I was midair when the revocation happened. And landed at Heathrow to find out that this had happened. And Monday morning, we find that Article 370, the article of the Constitution of India, which had been put in place to give special, which had special provisions for the state of Jammu and Kashmir. And the reason that was put in there is because the state, apart from defense, telecommunications, and foreign affairs, had its own autonomy. So to begin with, at the time the article was put in the constitution, the state had its own flag. The title of the person who later came to be known as chief ministers of the state used to be prime minister. So the state was in effect a state that had a significant level of autonomy to begin with. Now this autonomy was eroded by various governments over the successive decades. But what happens on the 5th of August is that unilaterally, without any consent, without any consultation of any Kashmiris, the article is taken out of the constitution. So the autonomy is just gone. It's an act of, it's obviously an egregious act of taking away the constitutionally guaranteed autonomy of a people without any consultation from them. Secondly, what also happens is that this is also constitutional vandalism. It's also a way of showing that the constitution can be tampered with in this way, as it were. And to make any changes, the proper way to have done it, apart from obviously seeking the consent of the people or consulting them, would have at least been to have the, legally, they would have been required to take the state legislature views into account. There was no state legislature because the government had been dissolved. And this, again, had been one of those practices that from the 50s to the 80s was pretty regular, to just dismiss governments that one didn't like from the center and to just impose governor's rule, which is direct rule from the center. So at that point, there was governor's rule. The center, which is the center in India, took it upon itself to take that, you know, my lawyer friends and Kashmiri lawyers certainly have written about this and spoken about this. The center took it upon itself the power that the state legislature would have had and said, well, on behalf of these people who aren't in the legislature right now, we're going to make this decision. And this decision literally happened overnight. And as soon as this decision was made and the autonomy revoked, there was this communication siege that was imposed. What do we mean by a communication siege? We mean that telephones, all telephones, landlines, mobiles, internet, everything was turned off. Now this is again not something completely unusual in that in Kashmir this has happened. In fact, I have myself been there on one occasion when mobile phones were turned off. So, you know, one moment you're there and you're able to communicate with people, the next moment it's just a little plastic box. It does nothing. But this, what has been unprecedented is the length of time that this has gone on for, and also the fact that it has, it was so blanket that it was even landlines. And from the 5th onwards, and the reason, the rationale given was that we're doing this because we fear that people would protest and there would be loss of life. It's a very problematic rationale for various reasons, and if you ask me, I can tell you more. But even even things like the public gatherings by parents of disappeared people that happens on the International Day of the Disappeared every year, even that sort of thing was not allowed. So it wasn't just that certain kinds of gatherings were not allowed. It was that no kind of gatherings were allowed. People's mobility was completely restricted. Political leaders were all detained. To the extent that, and you would have to think that this is really strange. Not only were they doing this to people whom they considered separatists, which is to say people who actually speak for self-determination, who speak about human rights, etc. Not only were they doing it to them, they were also doing it to the so-called mainstream population, mainstream politicians. So in effect, their own collaborators, people that they had been in partnership, in coalition with, to form a government up until, 2 years ago. So this was just, it didn't matter what kind of Kashmiri you were. It didn't matter whether you had actually, sung the praises of the Indian state to the Kashmiris and taken on that burden for whatever reason, ideology or opportunism. It didn't matter. All Kashmiris across the board were made completely, immediately irrelevant, whether they were civil society members, politicians, anyone. Journalists were stopped from leaving the country. We have read about no-fly lists that ban, that make it impossible for individuals who have, and certainly there's a report in The Wire, an Indian newspaper, The Wire and The Scroll will often report critically, most other media do not. In that report that about 450 people have been placed on these no-fly lists so that they cannot leave. The person, a Kashmiri man, Shah Faisal, who topped the Indian civil services exam, served in Kashmir, on behalf of the Indian state, happened to come on Hard Talk and talk about some of this, and he was stopped from leaving the country. So it doesn't matter who it was or what their position was, everyone entirely was just silenced. And this, the opening up of some of that communication has been arbitrary, has been done in a very kind of drip feed sort of a method. that the landlines were only restored, landline access was only restored in October. So that's after, you know, from August the 5th to October. And that too, I think, just a week before the US congressional hearing on human rights was held, which is the first time that Kashmir was discussed, and I was one of the people who gave expert testimony there. So just a week before that, or 10 days before that, we restored the landlines. Prepaid mobile phones, SMS services, text services are still not restored. Internet access is obviously not there for regular people. After some point, they set up certain media facilitation centers where only those journalists, and that means not freelance journalists, not anyone else, only those specific journalists from specific organizations that they wish to allow to use the internet are able to do so. And that too for a limited amount of time, like 15 minutes. There have been the courts, and that is the other sad aspect of this situation in Kashmir as it continues to unfold, is that the courts have not actually addressed this seriously. They initially deferred a lot of this because there's also the story of, you know, various things, and I can actually give you some statistics on this. So the emptying of democratic political and civil spaces has meant that schools were closed at first. When they were reopened in that atmosphere, the classrooms remained empty, so students haven't been able to pursue an education through all of this time. As I already told you, the Association of Parents of Disappeared People, which is led by Parveena Ahangar, who was nominated for the Nobel Prize. She's an elderly woman whose son was the victim of an enforced disappearances. And they are a organization, well-recognized organization, that on the 10th of every month gather in the center of Srinagar with pictures of their loved ones saying, please tell us what happened to them. Even that gathering was not allowed. The humanitarian crisis, of course, the businesses have suffered tremendously. The economy, the horticulture, export, you know, all of that. So there's losses to tourism, to all businesses, to IT, to anything basically that needs the internet. Then you think about the fact of people's access to medical services and how problematic that becomes when you don't have telephones and internet, when you can't place orders for replacement orders for medicines. And this is all, and now we are in winter time. So it's also a very harsh winter. It's compounded all of these difficulties. The humanitarian situation is compounded by the fact that people don't have electricity even, because it can just not function in that weather. So the economy has suffered massive losses, and it seems just so cruel to bank on making a population destitute, and to engender various kinds of debilities. Maybe people aren't being shot this autumn or this winter, but what is happening is that people are losing lives because they are unable to access medical care. Because there's all, and on top of that, imagine the trauma of living in that siege-like situation. If there is a security threat, every time that I say this, I feel like the state has no logic for what it is doing. Because if there is a security threat, well, what is it? If they come public with it, why would you not allow an American senator to visit, but take 24 specially selected far-right EU MEPs on a tour of a deserted Kashmir valley as a public relations exercise? So there are these AFD MPs and all others who go there, and then the EU says, well, actually, this is not an official delegation. So it was apparently a public relations move that totally fell flat, because it seemed that the entity that was organizing it had all sorts of dodgy connections. This all then came out in the media. And that in the emails that were sent to these far-right MPs, they were promised things like a meeting with the Prime Minister. This just happened recently, a few weeks ago. And so you wouldn't allow journalists to visit. You wouldn't allow American senators to visit. The only people internationally that you're quite happy with visiting are these 24 MEPs, who are the only people who have been taken there. Everyone else has various kinds of restrictions. The OHCHR, the UN... body, they produced extensive reports in the last couple of years documenting the situation on both sides, on Indian and Pakistani administered Kashmir, which has not been taken seriously. So there's that. All of these the collective punishment that is being imposed on these people who have a choice now to either try and go on living as best they can under the circumstances, in which case the state says, well, look, they're still alive, they're still functioning, therefore they must be happy with what they've done. Or to totally, you know, to remain completely shut down, and civil disobedience is one of the things that they have been practicing, in which case the idea is, well, you know, it's the militants that are telling them not to go about their lives, otherwise they would happily do so. The very fundamental democratic principle of seeking people's at least consultation, if not consent, when making a change that is as fundamental as this to their political rights, to their future, was not followed. Moreover, the state at the same time, in the same move that revoked the autonomy, the state was bifurcated into two and made into two union territories. So what used to be, so the idea is that Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh, the three regions, which were part of a state of Jammu and Kashmir, Ladakh was also part of that state, have now become two union territories. Jammu and Kashmir stay as one union territory and Ladakh becomes another union territory. It's divide and rule. But the idea of a union territory is that it isn't a state anymore. So a state has also been demoted from its position of being a state into a union territory, where one of the interesting things that happens in a union territory is that the police forces report directly to the Home Minister at the center. And the Home Minister at the center is Amit Shah, who's the right-hand person of the Indian Prime Minister, Modi, and he's also, and they've also, apart from, you know, there's this other broader Hindutva project that's been unfolding in India, part of which, and you might have heard of this, is the National Register of Citizens in Assam, in the northeastern state of Assam, and the idea of doing a nationwide citizenship creating a nationwide citizenship register and allowing non-Muslims from the neighboring countries to claim citizenship in India as refuge, but not Muslims from any countries, and Muslims within India would not be, and certainly the case of Assam revealed that, the idea is that Muslims are not wanted in India, and certainly, even if they cannot be removed, their rights become ever more precarious. And it isn't just the Muslims. Of course, it's the easiest targets to begin with. The Hindutva project also has had various kinds of issues. One of their organizations, VHP, Vishwa Hindu Parishad, has often had problems with Christians. And Christmas, one after Modi coming to power, in fact, Christmas was renamed Good Governance Day. And it's basically a problem of that would increasingly be something faced by all kinds of minorities, not even just religious minorities, but also people who dissent. Already, people who dissent are labeled as anti-nationals. And the discourse very much is that if you're not in agreement with us, you're anti-national and you should go.